Friends, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing unto you, for you are this community's rock and redeemer. He will come. This line, if you build it, he will come. This movie is over 25 years old, but we still know this famous line from Field of Dreams. It's the line that the humble Iowa farmer Ray Kinsella hears as he's out in the middle of his cornfield. If you build it, he will come. The voice speaks to him, comes to him, urging him to do this, as he even says, this completely illogical thing. But he sees a vision in the cornfield, a vision of a baseball field. And so even though Ray Kinsella has no idea who this voice is and why exactly he should do this, his spirit is stirred and he is compelled to build the baseball field. And he does. Plows under rows and rows of his valuable corn crop to build a field complete with lights and bleachers. Most people, when they watch Field of Dreams, they're just expecting another feel-good sports movie, especially today if you watch it, because Kevin Costner's kind of become known for those feel-good baseball movies. But when you watch this movie, it is a feel-good movie, but most viewers walk away with something more. The powerful thing that I noticed about this movie, maybe it was because I was watching it for the first time thinking about, okay, what is preachable about this? But the thing that is striking is that the voice in the movie and the Spirit of God actually sound a little bit alike. Follow me if you will. While most people went to have that inspiring message, as the preview said, when you believe the impossible, the incredible comes true. They went for just an inspiring message, but left with so much more. And I believe, as I watched it recently, it actually surprisingly becomes a parable, an insightful parable, insightful story of what it's like to listen to the Spirit of God. What's interesting about this is that the writer and director, Phil Robinson, he was one time invited to speak at a film festival that was hosted by a seminary. Fuller Seminary has a thing called Real, R-E-E-L, Real Spirituality, and their annual film festival invited the writer and director of Field of Dreams to come and speak. Of course, someone asked him, were you intentionally making this a spiritual movie? Did you have any spiritual intention for Field of Dreams? He shocked the audience by saying, no. He had no spiritual intention in making, or in the movie, Field of Dreams. This shocked the audience, but he did continue to say that over the years, he's received hundreds of letters from viewers who watched the movie and had a spiritual experience. Some even sent him thank you letters, thanking him because when they watched Field of Dreams, they watched a picture of God the Father. The movie gave them a picture of God the Father, and they left the movie theater feeling that their spirits had been lifted and they were transformed. Now, as I said earlier, clearly there is a difference between the voice that speaks to Ray Kinsella and the voice of the Spirit of God. But you must admit, the voice in the movie is quite reminiscent to the Spirit of God. And as I watched this movie about a man being called to a crazy adventure, to do a completely illogical thing, I can't help but think of all the call stories that we read in Scripture. And one of the first ones that comes to it's because of the voice, is the call story of Samuel. This is one of the most well-known and told call stories from Scripture. And I love this for a couple of reasons. The first reason that I love the call story of Samuel is the patient yet unrelenting nature of God in calling Samuel. You heard it. God calls out to Samuel not just once or twice or three times, but four times that night. God called out to Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. Each time Samuel gets up and runs to his mentor, Eli, the priest under whom he was learning and also living with. He goes to Eli every time thinking it's Eli calling his name, and finally the light goes off for Eli. This is the voice. This is the Spirit of God calling out to Samuel. And he tells Samuel, if you hear the voice again, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel goes and lays down after that third time, and God returns and calls out to Samuel, and Samuel gives that response. This is the second thing that I love about this story, is the way that Samuel responds, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Whenever we hear a call story, and especially when we hear a good call story, it invites us to recall our own call story. It begs us to remember the times that we have heard or felt God calling us. Now, I know that not all of us will experience an audible call or an audible voice calling us to do something. I remember when I was in college, I was studying to be a pharmacist, but it just didn't feel right. It didn't feel like this was what I was supposed to do. And in my heart, I wanted so badly to be a pastor. I wanted to work in the church, but I thought everybody wanted to work in the church and only a few got to. I wanted so badly to be a pastor, even though I didn't know what that meant or what it looked like. I had this desire in my heart to be a pastor. I wanted to preach. Yet, I was waiting on a voice. I was waiting on God to speak directly to me to say, Lynn, Lynn, so that I could say, finally, God, I've been waiting all this time for you to speak and call me. So one afternoon, I went to the prayer chapel at Malvern United Methodist Church, where I volunteered with the youth group, and I just laid on the prayer chapel floor, and I said, God, I want to be a pastor. Why don't you want me? I want to do this. If you want me to do this, just give me a sign. Just speak to me. God, here we are. We're in Malvern. I was thinking, you know, the church at Malvern rests on Highway 270. There were always people honking their horns at those red lights. And I said, God, if you want me to be in ministry, just let me hear a horn honk. So I laid there in the silence. And then a train went through town. What does a train do whenever it goes through a town? Honks the horn. When the train quit honking, I opened my eyes and I said, Lord, we both know that I meant a car horn. And I left the prayer chapel. Sometimes we cry out for that voice or for that sign. But for me, that wasn't what I needed. That ultimately wasn't what gave me the confirmation and the affirmation to take the next steps into going into ministry. For me, it was the patience and the relentlessness of God's call. The continual urging that I felt. I eventually realized that not everyone wants to preach. I don't know why. I eventually realized that not everybody wants to work in a church. And that the passions that were placed on my heart were God's call to me. And I'm grateful for God's patience and relentlessness. For it was that continual feeling deep down in my gut. The continual feeling that wasn't satisfied chasing other dreams and other visions. That passion deep inside me that said, go do something adventurous, like go to seminary, pursue ordination, preach the gospel. I know that God doesn't call all of us into ordained ministry or into professional ministry, but I do know with every fiber of my being that God does call every single one of us. Like the voice in the movie, God calls every one of us to crazy adventures, sometimes things that seem completely illogical. Ray Kinsella tells us at the beginning of the movie, before I heard the voice, I had never done a crazy thing in my life. When he looked out on the field, he turned to his wife and smiled and said, I have just done something completely illogical. And friends, the call of God leaves us feeling that way, that we have just signed up and started an adventure that will make no sense, perhaps, to people around us, but to us. To us, it's exciting. It's something we've just got to do. God may not call all of us to ordain a professional ministry, but God does indeed call all of us. God calls all of us in different ways, perhaps to teach the youth or the children's Sunday school class, to teach your own Sunday school class, calls us to share the gift of music, to guide people in prayer and in worship. God calls some of us to be busy with our hands, making things for others, preparing things for others, volunteering in ministries where we are the hands and the feet of Christ. God calls some of us to start a ministry that is not even started yet, just because we are the ones who are given the eyes to see and to recognize the need among us. God calls some of us, I've heard, to be plumbers, to be doctors, to be teachers, to be caregivers. God calls us all to use the talents and the gifts that we have so that we may fully experience the love of God and others may experience the love of God through us. And this thing about answering the call, one of the crazy things about the voice in the movie and about the voice, the Spirit of God, is that it does often leave us guessing. Even when I loaded up my car to go to seminary, I had no idea what was in store for me. I had no idea that one day I would be here with you. And I'm pretty serious in saying, you know, if I had known that I would get to be with y'all, I might have started this whole thing maybe a little bit earlier. Or not have been so slow to respond to God. The Spirit leaves us guessing because we don't know exactly what it will mean or what all of it will look like. When Ray built the field, he didn't know why. He didn't even exactly know who the he was who was going to come. And this is true for the way that God works as well. Even though I had the confidence to move forward in the call, wasn't sure what it would look like. Maybe this is where you are this morning. You feel God calling you to something. Maybe you've heard a voice. Maybe God has called you by name, asking you to do something, to go somewhere. Maybe you're like me and you have this unrelenting desire in your heart. But maybe you're scared about that next step. You're not sure what it's all going to look like. So So you're anxious to take that first step. You're anxious to actually put your name on the list to be a Sunday school class teacher. You're anxious to sign up to participate at Broadway Bridge. You're anxious to take that next step because you don't know exactly what it fully means. When God calls us, whether that be by the voice or by that urging, that desire that won't stop, that won't go away, we are given enough in that moment to begin. Well-known writer Anne Lamott once heard her speak, and she shared some of the best advice that she has ever received on writing. The advice is that writing is a lot like driving at night. Answering the call, I would say, is a lot like driving at night. When you're driving at night, you can only see as far as your headlights will illumine. But you can make it the whole trip that way. You don't have to see your destination in advance. You don't have to see all of the places you're going to pass along the way. You only need to see what's right in front of you. You can only see a few feet, but you can make the entire trip with just that. You only have to see what's right in front of you. Believe God lights what's right in front of us, giving us enough of the journey to see what's next. So friends, when you hear, when you feel, when you sense the voice of God calling you, lighting the first few steps ahead of you, may you respond, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Amen. Friends, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing unto you, for you are this community's rock and redeemer. He will come. This line, if you build it, he will come. This movie is over 25 years old, but we still know this famous line from Field of Dreams. It's the line that the humble Iowa farmer Ray Kinsella hears as he's out in the middle of his cornfield. If you build it, he will come. The voice speaks to him, comes to him, urging him to do this, as he even says, this completely illogical thing. But he sees a vision in the cornfield, a vision of a baseball field, and so even though Ray Kinsella has no idea who this voice is and why exactly he should do this, his spirit is stirred and he is compelled to build the baseball field, and he does. Plows under rows and rows of his valuable corn crop to build a field complete with lights and bleachers. Most people, when they watch Field of Dreams, are just expecting another feel-good sports movie, especially today if you watch it, because Kevin Costner's kind of become known for those feel-good baseball movies. But when you watch this movie, it is a feel-good movie, but most viewers walk away with something more. The powerful thing that I noticed about this movie, maybe it was because because I was watching it for the first time thinking about, okay, what is preachable about this? But the thing that is striking is that the voice in the movie and the Spirit of God actually sound a little bit alike, follow me if you will. While most people went to have that inspiring message, as the preview said, when you believe the impossible, the incredible comes true. They went for just an inspiring message, but left with so much more. And I believe, as I've watched it recently, it actually surprisingly becomes a parable, an insightful parable, insightful story of what it's like to listen to the Spirit of God. What's interesting about this is that the writer and director, Phil Robinson, he was one time invited to speak at a film festival that was hosted by a seminary. Fuller Seminary has a thing called Real, R-E-E-L, Real Spirituality, and their annual film festival invited the writer and director, Phil Dreams, to come and speak. Of course, someone asked him, were you intentionally making this a spiritual movie? Did you have any spiritual intention for Field of Dreams? He shocked the audience by saying, no. He had no spiritual intention in the movie Field of Dreams. This shocked the audience, but he did continue to say that over the years, he's received hundreds of letters from viewers who watched the movie and had a spiritual experience. Some even sent him thank you letters, thanking him because when they watched Field of Dreams, they watched a picture of God the Father. The movie gave them a picture of God the Father, and they left the movie theater feeling that their spirits had been lifted and they were transformed. Now, as I said earlier, clearly there is a difference between the voice that speaks to Ray Kinsella and the voice of the Spirit of God. But you must admit, the voice in the movie is quite reminiscent to the Spirit of God. And as I watched this movie about a man being called to a crazy adventure, to do a completely illogical thing, I can't help but think of all the call stories that we read in Scripture. And one of the first ones that comes to mind for me, I imagine it's because of the voice, is the call story of Samuel. This is one of the most well-known and told call stories from Scripture, and I love this for a couple of reasons. The first reason that I love the call story of Samuel is the patient yet unrelenting nature of God in calling Samuel. You heard it. God calls out to Samuel not just once or twice or three times, but four times that night. God called out to Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. Each time Samuel gets up and runs to his mentor, Eli, the priest under whom he was learning and also living with. He goes to Eli every time thinking it's Eli calling his name, and finally the light goes off for Eli. This is the voice. This is the Spirit of God calling out to Samuel. And he tells Samuel, if you hear the voice again, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel goes and lays down after that third time, and God returns and calls out to Samuel, and Samuel gives that response. This is the second thing that I love about this story, is the way that Samuel responds, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Whenever we hear a call story, and especially when we hear a good call story, it invites us to recall our own call story. It begs us to remember the times that we have heard or felt God calling us. Now, I know that not all of us will experience an church if only a few got to? I wanted so badly to be a pastor, even though I didn't know what that meant or what it looked like. I had this desire in my heart to be a pastor. I wanted to preach. Yet, I was waiting on a voice. I was waiting on God to speak directly to me to say, Lynn, Lynn, so that I could say, finally, God, I've been waiting all this time for you to speak and call me. So one afternoon, I went to the prayer chapel at Malvern United Methodist Church, where I volunteered with the youth group, and I just laid on the prayer chapel floor, and I said, God, I want to be a pastor. Why don't you want me? I want to do this. If you want me to do this, just give me a sign. Just speak to me. God, here we are. We're in Malvern. I was thinking, you know, the church at Malvern rests on Highway 270. There were always people honking their horns at those red lights. And I said, God, if you want me to be in ministry, just let me hear a horn honk. I laid there in the silence, and then a train went through town. What does a train do whenever it goes through a town? Honks the horn. When the train quit honking, I opened my eyes, and I said, Lord, we both know that I meant a car horn. And I left the prayer chapel. Sometimes we cry out for that voice or for that sign. But for me, that wasn't what I needed. That ultimately wasn't what gave me the confirmation and the affirmation to take the next steps into going into ministry. For me, it was the patience and the relentlessness of God's call. The continual urging that I felt. I eventually realized that not everyone wants to preach. I don't know. I eventually realized that not everybody wants to work in a church. And that the passions that were placed on my heart were God's call to me. And I'm grateful for God's patience and relentlessness. For it was that continual feeling deep down in my gut. The continual feeling that wasn't satisfied chasing other dreams and other visions. That passion deep inside me that said, go do something adventurous, like go to seminary, pursue ordination, preach the gospel. I know that God doesn't call all of us into ordained ministry or into professional ministry, but I do know with every fiber of my being that God does call every single one of us. Like the voice in the movie, God calls every one of us to crazy adventures, sometimes things that seem completely illogical. Ray Kinsella tells us at the beginning of the movie, before I heard the voice, I had never done a crazy thing in my life. When he looked out on the field, he turned to his wife and smiled and said, I have just done something completely illogical. And friends, the call of God leaves us feeling that way, that we have just signed up and started an adventure that will make no sense perhaps to people around us, but to us. To us, it's exciting. It's something we've just got to do. God may not call all of us to ordain a professional ministry, but God does indeed call all of us. God calls all of us in different ways. Perhaps to teach the youth or the children's Sunday school class, to teach your own Sunday school class, calls us to share the gift of music, to guide people in prayer and in worship. God calls some of us to be busy with our hands, making things for others, preparing things for others, volunteering in ministries where we are the hands and the feet of Christ. God calls some of us to start a ministry that is not even started yet, just because we are the ones who are given the eyes to see and to recognize the need among us. God calls some of us, I've heard, to be plumbers, to be doctors, to be teachers, to be caregivers. God calls us all to use the talents and the gifts that we have so that we may fully experience the love of God and others may experience the love of God through us. And this thing about answering the call, one of the crazy things about the voice in the movie and about the voice, the Spirit of God, is that it does often leave us guessing. Even when I loaded up my car to go to seminary, I had no idea what was in store for me. I had no idea that one day I would be here with you. And I'm pretty serious and saying, you know, if I had known that I would get to be with y'all, I might have started this whole thing maybe a little bit earlier. Or not have been so slow to respond to God. The Spirit leaves us guessing because we don't know exactly what it will mean or what all of it will look like. When Ray built the field, he didn't know why. He didn't even exactly know who the he was who was going to come. And this is true for the way that God works as well. Even though I had the confidence to move forward in the call, wasn't sure what it would look like. Maybe this is where you are this morning. You feel God calling you to something. Maybe you've heard a voice. Maybe God has called you by name, asking you to do something, to go somewhere. Maybe you're like me and you have this unrelenting desire. But maybe you're scared about that next step. You're not sure what it's all going to look like. So you're anxious to take that first step. You're anxious to actually put your name on the list to be a Sunday school class teacher. You're anxious to sign up to participate at Broadway Bridge. You're anxious to take that next step because you don't know exactly what it fully means. When God calls us, whether that be with a voice or by that urging, that desire that won't stop, that won't go away, we are given enough that moment to begin. Well-known writer Anne Lamott once heard her speak, and she shared some of the best advice that she has ever received on writing. The advice is that writing is a lot like driving at night. Answering the call, is a lot like driving at night. When you're driving at night, you can only see as far as your headlights will illumine. But you can make it the whole trip that way. You don't have to see your destination in advance. You don't have to see all of the places you're going to pass along the way. You only need to see what's right in front of you. You can only see a few feet, but you can make the entire trip with just that. You only have to see what's right in front of you. Believe God lights what's right in front of us, giving us enough of the journey to see what's next. So friends, when you hear, when you feel, when you sense,